Random House Audio presents Creationists, Selected Essays from 1993 through 2006 by E.L. Doctorow, as read by the author.
Introduction. This gathering of essays is a modest celebration of the creative act. It acknowledges composition as the reigning enterprise of the human mind. It affirms that we know by what we create. I attend here mostly to compositions that take the form of stories. I write such compositions myself, and so am interested in those who write them. A novel or a play has its origins in the peculiar excitements of the writer's mind. These are powerfully felt, even inspired responses to what may be the faintest or most fleeting of stimuli, an image, the sound of a voice, a kind of light, a word or phrase, a bar of music, or there may be an idea for which the writer has a strong sense of recognition, so strong that it becomes his to deal with as his domain. Of course, not all, in fact, very few, of the writer's states of arousal are resolved as finished works. Most are put aside for some mercurial reason. They are tried and found wanting in a page or so, or stashed away or forgotten completely. But I imagine them as a kind of ground song, these excitements, as constant and available as the sensation of life itself. Wherever fiction begins, whether in the music of words or an impelling anger, in a historic event, or the importunate hope of a justly rendered composition of one's own life. The work itself is hard and slow, and the writer's illumination becomes a taskmaster, a ruling discipline, jealously guarding the mind from all other and necessarily errant private excitements until the book is done, the script is finished. You live enslaved in the piece's language, its diction, its universe of imagery, and there is no way out except through the last sentence. Underlying everything, the evocative flashes, the dogged workings of language, is the writer's belief in the story as a system of knowledge. This belief is akin to the scientist's faith in the scientific method as a way to truth. Stories, whether written as novels or scripted as plays, are revelatory structures of facts. They connect the visible with the invisible, the present with the past. They propose life as something of moral consequence. They distribute the suffering so that it can be borne. To the skeptic who would not consider the story a reputable means of knowledge, the writer could point out that there was a time when there would have been nothing but stories, and no sharper distinction between what was fact and what was invented than between what was spoken and what was sung. Religion, science, simple urgent communication, and poetry were fused in the intense perception of a metaphor. Stories were the first repositories of human knowledge. They were as important to survival as a spear or a hoe. The storyteller practices the ancient way of knowing, the total discourse that antedates all the special vocabularies of modern intelligence. There is a scientist in this book as well. Scientific formulas are revelatory structures of facts. They too connect the visible with the invisible. And inevitably, they create realms of moral consequence. I argue here that the experience of discovering a scientific truth is for the scientist the same as the achievement of a realized work for the writer. In either case, is there a lingering sense of personal possession? The effort of one's mind seems, on completion, the work of outside forces. For all creationists, there is a strange displacement. The creative mind dissociates from what it has created. There is no memory of the effort involved. The book, the formula, becomes something out there, as if it appeared of its own volition. I assume the experience is the same for the composer of music, the painter, the sculptor, the architect, the engineer. But the comedic mime, whose composition is in his physical deportment, whose revelations are composed as gestures, lives like the dancer in his expressive musculature, his art molded from his being. Human creativity would seem to be rampant. From infancy, the mind ascribes meaning to the unmeant. It lights what it sees and makes a home of the world. The results are not always benign. Our inventiveness is boundless and can be at its most dazzling as it breaches the moral imperatives we've created for ourselves. Like the communal composition out of Los Alamos, it can have horrifying consequences. In the history of literature, some of the most beautiful, most profound works have been composed by the most wretched of souls. There is no necessary equivalence between the aesthetic and moral achievement of a novel and the confused, drunken, tormented, or immoral package of humanity who's produced it. Whatever sublimity inheres in the work does not necessarily exhibit itself in the author. But the writers about whom I write do have a certain radiance in my eyes. I may not be uniformly positive in my judgments, but underlying all my attentions is a collegial homage, a sympathy, even a love, for the aesthetic struggle as it shines with a kind of blessedness. After all, why compose fiction when you could be devoting your life to your appetites? Why wrestle with a book when you could be amassing a fortune? Why write when you could be shooting someone? True storytellers ply their imaginations with a kind of self-questioning arrogance. They would reassert the authority of the single mind to render the world. They may not realize when they commit to the practice of fiction that they're ordained to contest the aggregate fictions of their societies. That, of course, is their redeeming value, but also an indication of the risk they take. It can be a dangerous profession, storytelling. If actuarial figures of writers' lifespans worldwide were to be calculated, taking into account the jailings, the deportations, the executions, the disappearances, as well as the humdrum deaths from malnutrition and neglect, you would not want your son or daughter to become a writer. Apart from such hazards, there is an entropic cost to the calling. Writing is not merely a matter of setting down words. A novel is written at the expense of the novelist's being. Eventually, there is not much more to him that hasn't been written away. It may be the peculiar fate of the writer that after a lifetime of writing, he becomes mysterious to himself, his identity having dissolved into his books. Finally, the enterprise of writing gives no warrants. The few monumental works that change our thinking, our seeing, rise from the chatter of what is temporal, imitative, foolish, and easily forgettable. The writer will never know if his work will flash forth a light from his own time and place, across borders and through the ages. His own time and place clutching and pulling at his feet of clay every day of his working life. He will know only how faint a light it is and how easily doused. And so, all in all, a degree of courage is involved in the practice, even if the writer, as he flourishes in the realization of his first book, may not be aware of it. He will be taught about courage in any case. All creationists are mortal. Genesis. The King James Version of the Bible, an early 17th century translation, seems by its now venerable diction to have added a degree of poetic luster to the ancient tales, genealogies, and covenantal events of the original. It is the version preachers quote from who believe in the divinity of the text. Certainly in the case of Genesis 1-4, in which the world is formed and populated, and Adam and Eve are sent from the garden, there could be no more appropriate language than the English of Shakespeare's time. The King James does not suffer at all from what is inconsistent or self-contradictory in the text, any more than do the cryptic ancient Hebrew and erring Greek from which it's derived. Once you assume poetically divine authorship, only your understanding is imperfect. But when you read of these same matters in the contemporary diction of the Revised Standard Version, the Jamesian voice of Holy Scripture is not quite what you hear. In plain-spoken modern English, Genesis, especially as it moves on from the flood and the Tower of Babel, and comes up in time through the lives of Abraham, Sarah, Isaac, Rebecca, and then to the more detailed adventures of Jacob and Rachel and Joseph and his brothers, seems manifestly of the oral tradition of pre-literate storytelling out of which the biblical documents emerged.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.